Hi guys, welcome back to Watch With Us. My name is John Keel, and let's get right into a wrist check because it has everything to do with today's video. I am currently wearing a Royal Oak Offshore that is actually not mine, it's a friend of mine's. I helped him acquire this watch through an authorized dealer friend of mine about 2 months ago. I said, you know, I'd love to get a closer look at that watch for the Watch With Us channel. So he stopped by the Watch Gauge headquarters the other day, dropped it off, and that is what we will be talking about today, as well as a brief history of the Audemars Piguet Royal Oak. Now, there are dozens and dozens and dozens, if not more, people out there who know a lot more about the history of the Royal Oak, as well as the Royal Oak collection, than I do. During my years in retail, I was lucky enough to work in an authorized retailer of Audemars Piguet, so I do have some experience, and AP happens to be one of my very favorite brands on the planet. When I think about what are the most iconic watches ever made, a handful of pieces come to mind. Certainly would be the Rolex Submariner as well as the Daytona, the Lange 1, possibly the 50 Fathoms by Blancpain. And in my mind, one of the most, if not the most iconic watches on the planet is the Royal Oak from Audemars Piguet. Before we get into a closer look at this particular watch, let's talk briefly about the history of the Audemars Piguet Royal Oak. Now, just a quick point before I get into it, most of the information I've gotten from my time in retail selling Audemars Piguet, as well as from reading a handful of different blog articles and magazine articles and things of that nature. So although I believe most of this information to be extremely accurate, I am only going based on what I've read in the past. If for any reason that I am incorrect on any of the statements, I would love for you to leave a comment below and give me a correction on them, because I genuinely want to know, and I'm sure that our viewers would love to know as well. In 1971, at the height of the quartz crisis in the watch industry, while all of the Swiss luxury brands were trying to figure out what their future may hold, Audemars Piguet was being urged by their Italian market for a stainless steel luxury sport watch that could appeal to a younger, hipper crowd, yet still have the refinement of a luxury watch. Something they can wear on all occasions, whether it be in a sporty atmosphere or dressed up in a suit or a tux. The man tasked with designing what would become the Royal Oak was Swiss watch designer Gerald Genta. Already an accomplished watch designer, Gerald Genta had designed watches for the likes of Universal Geneve, Omega, and Patek Philippe. It's rumored that the original design for the Royal Oak was sketched on a cocktail napkin. I don't know how true that is, but it certainly adds to the mystique of the story. A year later, in 1972, at the Basel Fair, the AP Royal Oak reference 5402 was born. In a world where there was never any correlation between the words stainless steel and luxury, and while the entire industry was rushing to quartz movements and thinner watches, and while many men were wearing watches in the size of 32 to 35 millimeters in diameter, who would have thought that a 39 millimeter stainless steel sports watch, that by the way cost more than 10 times the amount of a Rolex Submariner, would be the watch that would come in and save a company and become one of the most iconic watches in history. Now, from what I've read, at that time, a Rolex Submariner could be purchased for somewhere around $230 to $250. And again, based on what I've read, the initial offering price of the Royal Oak 5402 was 3,300 Swiss francs. So naturally, as you'd imagine, the entire industry panned the idea. They thought Audemars was making a huge mistake. They thought they were crazy. It is said that Audemars Piguet made about 1,000 5402s in 1972. And it is also said that it took almost 2 years to sell all of those pieces. So naturally, it wasn't an instant hit. But then something changed. Audemars was very persistent with their marketing and their targeting of the young, the hip, the ultra wealthy. And within a few short years, the Royal Oak became a symbol of wealth, a symbol of being the it watch. The design elements that made the Royal Oak unique was the octagonal bezel with white gold octagonal screws recessed into that bezel. A bracelet that was integrated into the case, incorporated of horizontal links as well as twin connecting center links. And the dial had a very unique petite tapestry pattern that was engine turned into the dial. Gerald Genta was noted saying that the Royal Oak was the masterpiece of his career. Over the years, various different versions were made in not only steel, but steel and gold, as well as solid gold, and many complications were added, including a day-date moon phase, the chronograph, the dual time with power reserve, a tourbillon, an ultra-thin perpetual calendar, and the equation of time. Fast forward 21 years from the release of the original 5402, AP was once again looking to appeal to a younger, more hip crowd than the people that were buying the current offerings of the Royal Oak. And once again at the Basel Fair in 1993, the Royal Oak Offshore was introduced. The reference 25721 featured many of the same design elements, including the octagonal bezel and screws, integrated bracelet with similar link stylings, and once again, that tapestry dial, but instead of being the petite tapestry dial, was a bit more embellished, a bit larger. Nicknamed the Beast, the dimensions of the Royal Oak Offshore were huge compared to what everybody was wearing of the day. The quartz crisis still wasn't over, and people were still desiring thinner and smaller watches. And once again, the industry scoffed at the idea of such a large, robust watch. Broadly, the Offshore did not sell all that well. I read somewhere that it did sell well initially in Italy, but once again, it took a few years for the world to catch on to the Royal Oak Offshore. I remember personally back in the early 2000s while working behind the counter at an AP authorized dealer where I was selling Royal Oaks hand over fist, and yet the Offshores would just sit in the case and nobody would buy them. And in my experience, it was somewhere around 2002, 2003 where the sales of the Royal Oak Offshore really started to increase. And as I recall personally, it was in the early to mid 2000s when AP started to collaborate with the likes of Arnold Schwarzenegger with the Royal Oak Offshore, both through his charitable foundation as well as some watches that they collaborated on for movies. In particular, the watch that Arnold wore on the sixth day, as well as the T3 or the Terminator 3 AP Royal Oak Offshore. And like the original Royal Oak, many different versions as well as many different complications were incorporated into the Royal Oak Offshore case. It was this bold move back in 1971 and 1972 by Audemars Piguet that created this iconic collection of watches. And for the past few decades, again, particularly in my experience, the Audemars Piguet Royal Oak and the Offshore have been one of the most sought after and hottest collections in the watch industry. It is easily safe to say that the Royal Oak collection is one of the most iconic designs and timepiece collections in the industry's history. With that, let's take a closer look at the Royal Oak Offshore reference 26470 that was so graciously lent to me by my good friend Andrew. The AP Royal Oak reference 26470 embodies many of the design elements that were created by Gerald Genta back in 1972. The signature octagonal bezel with 18 karat white gold octagonal screws that are flush. In this watch's case, the bezel is ceramic, which is high polished on the bevels, but has a beautiful linear pattern on the top side. The case measures 42 millimeters by 14.6 millimeters thick. I think that the black ceramic bezel works perfectly with the dial and the handset, with the dial being multi-layered, black with the large tapestry engine-turned pattern, applied Arabic numerals full of superluminova, and the red accent coloring on the second hand, the chronograph hands, as well as on the inner bezel tachometer scale. The magnified date is at 3 o'clock. I do love how they magnified the date without it being a bubble on the crystal, which is a personal pet peeve of mine. The chronograph pushers and the crown are also black ceramic, with the crown being a screw down crown. Taking a look at the back side of the watch, which is arguably more beautiful than looking at the front side of the watch, through a sapphire crystal, you can see the in-house manufacturer caliber 3126/3840, which beats at 21,600 beats per hour, or 3 hertz. The movement has a whopping 59 joules and 50 hours of power coming from its bidirectional winding. You'll notice that the rotor is gold. It's actually solid 22 karat gold, beautifully engraved with ceramic ball bearings. For me, what truly makes a luxury watch exceptional is the execution and the finish of the movement. And although the caliber 3126 is robust and extremely durable like the Royal Oak itself, the way the bridges are engraved and the diamond cut bevels on the plates and bridges is absolutely stunning. The truth of the matter is, for me personally, I could sit and stare at a watch movement like this under a loop for a very long time and just continue to appreciate it. And this is what sets brands like Audemars Piguet, Patek Philippe, and a host of others up on the top of the pack when it comes to hot horology. And when you're spending $26,000 and change on a stainless steel sport wristwatch, you'd only expect the best like you'd get from Audemars Piguet. Once again, I really want to thank my friend Andrew for leaving this with me for this video. I hope that you guys enjoyed it. As I mentioned in the beginning of this video, if any of the information that I put out in this video is a little bit incorrect, again, I got it from a host of online sources as well as my personal experience. And if there are any amendments or any changes, please leave them in the description below, because once again, I'm truly interested and I'm sure that everybody watching this video would be as well. So if you did like the video, hit that little thumbs up button below. Don't forget to subscribe to the Watch With Us YouTube channel if you have not already, as well as follow us on Instagram at Watch With Us Channel. Oh, just a reminder, or if you haven't heard already, we are doing a giveaway, our second giveaway here on Watch With Us. We're giving away two fantastic watches and an absolutely gorgeous fountain pen. The rules are very simple to enter. Subscribe to this YouTube channel, follow us on Instagram, and sign up for our newsletter on our website, www.media.com. I shot a giveaway video recently. I'll leave a link in the description below to that video so you can check that out. We truly appreciate you taking your time to watch our videos, and we'll be coming right back at you with another video very, very soon. Until then, take care, guys. Thank you.